In this video lecture, we are going to discuss our next topic in information retrieval, which is called normalization. So far we have discussed various topics related to information retrieval, such as how to obtain the character sequence from a digital document, then how to determine what should be the document unit for indexing purpose. And in the previous lectures, we have discussed what is tokenization and stop words. So before going into the normalization part, first we have to understand the problem. So as we know about tokenization, so in tokenization, the easy case may be if tokens in the query just match the tokens in the token list of the document. Okay, then tokens in the query directly matches with the tokens that are available in the list of documents. So this is an easy case. But there are many cases when these two character sequences are not quite the same, but still we would like a match to occur for these cases. So for instance, if somebody searches for USA and U.S.A. then we might hope to also match the document containing both the terms as one. Okay, so whether we search for USA or whether we search for U.S.A, the answer should be same. For that, we have to perform normalization. So normalization is nothing but a process for converting the tokens to terms. Okay, so as the definition says, it is the process of canonicalizing tokens so that matches occur despite the differences in the character sequences of the tokens. Okay. So the most standard way to perform this normalization is generating equivalence classes. And these equivalence classes are normally named after one member of the available set. So for example, suppose we have the tokens anti-discriminatory and second token is anti-discriminatory without any hyphen or space. If we normalize both these terms, both these tokens, then they both are mapped into a single term that is called as anti-discriminatory without any hyphen or space character. Okay. So to generate these equivalence classes, the most common rules we have to follow that the first rule says delete the periods to form a term. That is, if we have these dot characters and we have two terms like U.S.A. and second token is USA, then we'll map both the tokens to a single term, that is USA. And second rule say that is deleting hyphens to form a term. Like we have two terms, anti-discriminatory and anti-discriminatory, then they will be mapped into a single term, that is anti-discriminatory. Okay, so this is how we generate equivalence classes. But there is some limitation with these equivalence classes. So what is that limitation? The limitation is it does not maintain the relationship between unnormalized tokens. So as an alternative approach, we can go for the next approach, which is called as asymmetric expansion to perform normalization. So to understand asymmetric expansion, first we take a look at the example part. Suppose we have a term window and we want that if somebody enters this term, then this should also searches for these terms. And if somebody enters this term, then this should map to these terms also. And if somebody enters this type of token, then it should also match for the Windows terms. Okay. So the idea is if we enter a single token to search, then it should map multiple terms so that it can generate more relevant documents. Okay. So for we can say this is potentially more powerful but less efficient. The second advantage of performing asymmetric expansion is it deals with the handling of synonyms and homonyms. Like if we generate hand constructed equivalence classes, that if somebody wants to map when somebody searches for car, it should also search for automobile, because car and automobile both are related terms. So in such cases, asymmetric expansion works. And as we know, the writing conventions of different English languages, that is US English and British English. So there are difference between the spellings. Like one language suggests the spelling of color may be COLOR and other one suggests COLOUR. But as we are performing normalization, then we would like to map both these terms, both these tokens to a single term, that is color. So for what we are doing in asymmetric expansion, we are just simply rewriting the equivalence classes. So we can rewrite to form equivalence class terms that, for example, when the document contains automobile, so we can index it under car and automobile both, and vice versa. Okay, and we can further expand this query by taking example, suppose when a query contains automobile, then we can map it under car as well, or we can look under car as well. So this is how asymmetric expansion works. Okay, that's why it is potentially more powerful than equivalence classes. The other issues that we face during normalization are the uses of ascent and diatricks. So first we consider the cases of ascents. Like in French language, there is a term which is called as cliché, and English it is also pronounced as cliché. But with the help of this ascent, it is read as cliché in French language. But when we write a query to search about these terms, then they both the tokens term map should map under a single term, that is a cliché. Okay. Similarly, umlauts. In German language, suppose we have a term, say Tübingen, that is T-U-E-B-I-N-G-A-N. And when it is written in German language specifically with the help of umlauts, then it is written as T-U with the umlaut sign B-I-N-G-E-N. So both of the term should generate equal result. But there are certain limitations with this also. Like if we take an example of Spanish language, then it has a term pena, which means a cliff. Whereas in general English language, the pena stands for sorrow. So both of the terms are totally different, but they would map to a single result or single document. So this is a kind of a problem that we face during normalization. But what is our most important criteria to perform normalization? That is, we have to focus how users like to write their queries for these words. So if we follow French language, German language or English language that may contain ascents and may contain diatricks, may contain, that is, umlauts, then users may not like to type the queries with these ascents or umlauts. They would love to write the queries in simple English. Okay. So it may be best to normalize without diacritics. Like if we have terms, tokens, that is Tübingen with the umlaut, and this Tübingen without E. All these three tokens would map to a single term, that is, what would be normalized as a single term, that is Tübingen without E and without umlaut, to generate best possible results. Okay. So this is normalization. The second part of this lecture contains the introduction of case folding. So in general sense, case folding means the reduction of all letters or uppercase letters to a lowercase. Okay. So this is a very good idea for performing the normalization, as we know that if somebody wants to search for automobile, then it should also match with the term automobile. So these capitalization of characters should be converted into lowercase automatically. So that is the part that case folding performs, as well as it is also helpful for web search engines in such cases where most of the users suppose type for Ferrari when they are interested in Ferrari car, that is that stands for capital F, starts with capital F. So this is why case folding is a better option, because if somebody writes a query with the capitalization letters, then it directly converts into small case letters so that it can map or generate more relevant documents. Okay, but there is also a limitation with this too, that is case folding. So on the other hand, we can say such type of case folding can equate words that might better be kept apart. Meaning, suppose if I want to search for a term, I have a token, that is C dot A dot T dot. suppose that stands for common admission test. Then if we perform normalization, then it will simply remove these dots and convert it into simple CAT. And if you perform case folding on that, then it will convert it to small CAT cat. So if my query was intended to search for the common admission test, then it might generate results that are related to cat as an animal. Okay, so it in such cases, the case folding fails to generate good results. Okay, so what is the solution we have? So as a solution, we have next technique, which is called as true casing. Okay, so what true casing suggests? It suggests that instead of making every token lowercase, we can make only some tokens into a lowercase letters. For that, the simple rule suggests, if your document or if the words are coming from the beginning of the sentence, then we'll simply convert it, it into lowercase words. If the words are coming from the title part, that is all in uppercase, then we'll convert it into lowercase again. But if somebody is writing capitalized words during the mid of the sentence, then it may be possible that it has certain meaning. Like if my query contains, I want the information about C.A.T, then I am intended to search the document that contains common admission test. Okay. So it is better to left them as capitalized, which will generate usually good results or correct results. So in information retrieval, this task can be more accurately performed by machine learning sequence model. Okay, that we train a machine and then machine predict which document or which word it has to convert it into lowercase or which word it has to left as capitalized. Okay, so this is all about normalization, case folding and true casing. In the next lecture, we will discuss about the stemming. Okay, and later we will discuss about lemmatization. So if you have any query, then you can ask in our comment section. And if you like our videos, then kindly subscribe our channel. Thank you so much.